بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن والاه أما بعد. This is our 42nd and final lesson going through the book الأربعون النووية, authored by Imam النووي رحمه الله تعالى. There are two hadith remaining, the first hadith being عن أبي محمد عبد الله بن عمرو بن العاص رضي الله عنهما قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لا يؤمن أحدكم حتى يكون هواه تبعا لما جئت به. حديث حسن رويناه من كتاب الحجة بإسناد صحيح. النووي رحمه الله تعالى graded this hadith as an authentic hadith, as a fair and authentic hadith that has been transmitted from the book كتاب الحجة. And the كتاب الحجة is a book written by أبو الفتح نصر بن إبراهيم المقدسي رحمه الله تعالى. وهذا الحديث حديث ضعيف. This is a weak hadith due to the chain of narration having in it weak narrators. As mentioned by Shaykh al-Albani رحمه الله تعالى, شيخ مشايخنا الإمام الألباني رحمه الله تعالى, and also mentioned by رجب بن الصالح جامع العلوم والحكم. However, the meaning of this hadith is very, very authentic, and it's based upon the verse of Allah عز وجل, وما كان لمؤمن ولا مؤمنة إذا قضى الله ورسوله أمرا أن يكون لهم الخيارة من أمرهم ومن يعص الله ورسوله فقد ضل ضلالا مبينا. So Abi Muhammad Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As, من السبعة المكثيرين عن النبي الأمين صلى الله عليه وسلم رضي الله عنهما. And this is the first hadith that Ibn Amr ibn al-As, Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As narrates in this book. That the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, لا يؤمن أحدكم حتى يكون هواه تبعا لما جئت به. And none of you will truly believe until his inclination, his desires are in accordance to that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent down upon the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, and that which the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم has come with from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this hadith, it encompasses the whole of Islam. The whole of Al-Islam. And rather it defines for us what is true Iman. True Iman, true belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is that your desires are in accordance and in line with that which the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has come with from the Sharia. And so the Quran and Sunnah, huwa al-hakam. The Quran and Sunnah is the judge. The Quran and the Sunnah is the judge by which, and it's the mizan, the scale, by which we measure our deeds upon. If our deeds are in accordance to the Kitab and the Sunnah, then Alhamdulillah. And if it's not, then we don't truly believe until we force our desires and force our actions to become in alliance and in accordance to the Kitab and the Sunnah. To the Kitab and the Sunnah. فَلَا يُؤْمِنُ وَحَدُنَا. None of us truly believes until our desire is in accordance to the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. فَنَتَّبِعْ وَلَا نَبْتَدِعْ. We follow and we do not innovate. The same way that a person has the desire to sleep. If you have a desire to sleep, what do you go and do? You go and sleep. It's the same way that you have to have the desire for the salah, and the zakah, and the siyam, and the hajj, and the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. فَإِذَا أَتَاكَ شَيْءٌ. So if someone comes to you, بِسُنَّةِ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. A person comes to you and said, قَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. So on. Messenger of Allah said something. You have to force your desires to follow that sunnah. You have to follow that sunnah. So when it comes to the concept of مثلا رفع اليدين في الصلاة, when it comes to the concept of رفع اليدين في الصلاة, the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم, it is authentically transmitted from him that he raised his hands during the prayer. رفع يديه عند الركوع وعند القيام من الركوع وعند القيام من التشهد الأول عليه الصلاة والسلام. So you now as a Muslim, that hadith comes to you, تسلم له. You submit to it and you make your desires inclined towards that hadith and towards that sunnah, not towards قال فلان قال علان قال X قال Y من الأئمة. لا, نتبع رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. وما كان لمؤمن ولا مؤمنة إذا قضى الله ورسوله أمرا أن يكون لهم الخيارة من أمرهم ومن يعص الله ورسوله فقد ضل ضلالا مبينا. فنصلي ونصوم كما صام وصلى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. That's what this hadith is trying to show to us. That our desires, our opinions, our subjective views have to be all in accordance to the sunnah of the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم. Have to be in accordance to the sunnah of the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم. تسير هواك على شرع الله سبحانه وتعالى. للعكس, you put your desires and you drag your desires towards the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and you remove
all of the desires that lead you to muharramat or lead you to that which disobeys the sunnah of the Messenger of Allah sallam, and you take that which obeys the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Not the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you take and you change it according to your desires. Like we see today, many people do, following other than the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, number one. And those who claim to follow the sunnah, they follow the sunnah by twisting the sunnah and then claiming what they've twisted to be the sunnah. فَنَسْأَلُ اللَّهَ السَّلَامَةَ وَالْعَافِيَةَ. And so this hadith, it is ضعيف in terms of its sanad, but in terms of its meaning, it is sound. فَالْإِمَامُ النَّوِّي رَحِيمُ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى brought this hadith, and it's a very, very important hadith, and it has very, very important ramifications. And as for the final hadith, which is a beautiful, beautiful hadith, وعن أنس بن مالك رضي الله عنه قال سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول قال الله تعالى يا ابن آدم إنك ما دعوتني ورجوتني غفرت لك على ما كان منك ولا أبالي يا ابن آدم لو بلغ ذنوبك عنان السماء ثم استغفرتني غفرت لك يا ابن آدم إنك لو أتيتني بقراب الأرض خطايا ثم لقيتني لا تشرك بي شيئا لا أتيتك بقرابها مغفرة. This hadith reported by Tirmidhi, وقال حديث حسن صحيح. The مصنف رحمه الله تعالى brought this hadith in order to show that su'alullah, asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness, is something which is obligatory, and it's something which is something that we need to come with, and that is number one, du'a'ullahi wahda, that we call upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, we seek from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgiveness from him, tabarakat asma'uhu wa jalla sifatuhu wahdahu la sharika lah wa qala rabbukum ud'uni astajib lakum. And here we find that Ibn Adam, or son of Adam, and of course we are all from Adam, kulluna min Adam wa Adam min turab, innaka ma da'awtani wa rajawtani ghafartu laka ala ma kana minka wa la ubali, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he has, as long as you, O Abdullah, call upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, make this dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, have this hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive you no matter what you do, without hesitation. وَلَا أُبَالِي means without hesitation. فَدُعَاءُ اللَّهِ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى is something which is مَطْلُوبٌ شَرْعًا, it is something which is necessary from you in order to attain the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, no matter what sin you do. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said in the Quran, قُلْ يَا عِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ أَسْرَفُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ لَا تَقْنَطُوا مِنْ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ جَمِيعًا إِنَّهُ هُوَ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, وَاسْتَغْفِرُوا رَبَّكُمْ إِنَّهُ كَانَ غَفَّارًا يُرْسِلِ السَّمَاءَ عَلَيْكُمْ مِدْرَارًا. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, وَاسْتَغْفِرُوا رَبَّكُمْ ثُمَّ تُوبُوا إِلَيْهِ إِنَّ رَبِّي رَحِيمٌ وَدُودٌ. And so we find in many of these ayat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is encouraging us and encouraging us that we become from those people who return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, call upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, seek forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the sins that we have incurred upon ourselves. And as we know, kullu ibn Adam khatta, every son of Adam is a sinner, wa khayru khatta'in at-tawwabun. And so this hadith is very important in that it re-establishes in our hearts, it reinvigorates in our heart the concept of returning back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in forgiveness, no matter what sin we do, no matter how big the sin is, no matter how small the sin is, we return back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala seeking repentance from him. And that we have certainty when we are performing this dua, that this dua that we perform, that this dhikr that we read, these invocations that we have, these supplications that we make, that we are certain Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hears it, and that we are certain Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will accept it. نعم. And then the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentions in hadith, which is hadith Qudusi, قال الله تعالى يا ابن آدم لو بلغ ذنوبك عنان السماء ثم استغفرتني غفرت لك. This again is re-establishing, reinvigorating, reaffirming the notion of al-istighfar from no matter whatever sin you commit, whether it's the sin like murder or shirk, whatever sin it is, ارجع إلى ربك, return back to your Lord Allah عز وجل, no matter how large your sins become, even if it fills up the whole heavens and the whole earth, then seek forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, فإنه يغفر لك, verily Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive you. And of course, the istighfar, the waqt of al-istighfar, the waqt of tawbah, is whilst you are on this earth, before two things. Number one, the death, before death reaches you, or the general sign, which is before the sun rises from the west. If the sun rises from the west, the door for tawbah and istighfar is shut. And likewise, for every single person, the door for tawbah closes when the soul reaches the throat and is about to come out and death has reached you. وليست التوبة للذين يعملون السيئات حتى إذا حضر أحدهم الموت قال إني تبت الآن ولا الذين يموتون وهم كفار أولئك أعتدنا لهم عذابا أليما. طيب and likewise the messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم the messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم he said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept the tawbah of any one of you ما لم يغرغر, as long as he doesn't reach this level of the pangs of death have reached him, when he reaches that stage when death is very very close and about to take him, then the door for repentance has been closed. So as long as you have not reached that stage, and of course right now we haven't reached that stage, we might reach it in the future, but before that we need to be now, we need to repent now, not repent later. Do not delay the repentance, do not delay your repentance, return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala now. And then he ends the hadith عليه الصلاة والسلام يا ابن آدم إنك لو أتيتني بقرى بالأرض خطايا ثم لقيتني لا تشرك بي شيئا لأتيتك بقرى بها مغفرة. Now we're talking about the one who dies. Maybe he didn't commit tawbah. Maybe he died whilst not performing the repentance. And so the messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم he said, if you die and you meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with all sins apart from الشرك بالله عز وجل, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive you. So we find here the danger of ashirku billah, that every single sin you are under the mashia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in sha'a afa ank wa in sha'a lam ya'fu ank, or lam yaghfir lak wa adhabak. So everybody who meets Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with sins that they did not make tawbah from, then this sin can either be one of two, imma an yakuna shirkan aw ghayr shirk, it's either polytheism or not shirk. Shirk or not shirk. If it's shirk, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not forgive the person who comes on a day of judgment with shirk billah azza wa jal. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرُ أَن يُشْرَكَ بِهِ وَيَغْفِرُ مَا دُونَ ذَلِكَ لِمَن يَشَاءَ. And as we know, the shirk is of two types, shirk akbar and shirk asghar. And as you know, shirk akbar is renders a person to abide in the hellfire for eternity. دخول تأبيد, which is the entrance into hellfire for eternity. لا يخرج منها خالدا مخلدا فيها. The one who dies upon الشرك بالله عز وجل الشرك الأكبر. And as for الشرك الأصغر, then the person will enter into the fire and he will be punished and he will be cleansed, but then he will be taken out. And this is not as دخول تأميد. This person will be entered into the hellfire for a specific amount of time, and then he'll be taken out from it and then placed into the heaven, placed into paradise. And so this غفران is for the one who didn't come with الشرك بالله عز وجل. And the one who didn't come with الشرك بالله عز وجل, even if he came with any other sin, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala might forgive him for that sin, and he won't enter into the fire, but he goes into paradise straight away. Or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cleanses him by punishing him in the grave and punishing him in the fire, and then taking him out and putting him into paradise. So that's what this hadith deals with. This hadith is a very important hadith that tells us and highlights to us the importance of returning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in repentance, not delaying the repentance, and ensuring that we die upon at-tawheed, that we die upon tawheedullahi azza wa jal, that we live and we die upon at-tawheed, and that we do not die upon ash-shirku billahi azza wa jal. And one of the ways in which a person seeks forgiveness from ash-shirk is to say, Allahumma inni a'udhu bika al-ushrika wa an a'lam wa astaghfiruka lima la a'lam, that I seek refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from committing shirk whilst I know, and I seek forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for that which I do not know, or that which I have done unwillingly, or that which I have done unknowingly. Na'am. And so with this, the Musannif Nawawi rahimahullah ta'ala ended the 42 ahadith al-arba'una fi al-mabani. The title of the book is kitabuhu al-arba'una fi mabani al-ahkam wa qawa'id al-deen, the 40 hadith concerning the general foundational principles and rulings of this religion. And these ahadith, as we've seen, as we've gone through, they are all ahadith which are min jawami' kalimi rasulillahi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, from the comprehensive speech of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Nas'al Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala an yataqabbala minna wa an yaj'ala amalana hadha khalisan li wajhihi al-karim innahu waliy dhalika wa mawlah. Subhanaka Allahumma wa bihamdik ashhadu an la ilaha illa ant astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk, wassalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.